When you start working, there are many skills which you can compromise. Let's say you might not write any single test case for 2 years, but guys, there is no way you will not write a bug report. And it might happen your very first day at work. So we want you to understand the bug tracking systems, and we want you to understand how to write bug reports. And let's take a look at my screen now. On my screen, you are seeing the survey kind of summary screen. And here is question number one. Let's go question by question, because they are either typical interview questions or kind of close to them. So the first one says, what fields tester fills out in a bug report? The subtle detail here is, it's not talking about fields of a bug report form. It is talking about fields which tester fills out. Certain fields tester will not fill out. So other people will do that. So bug report ID, guys, bug report ID, it is very rare for a tester to type in bug report ID. No, normally bug report IDs are generated by bug tracking system. You just say new report and it comes with a number. Or in Element tool, the one which we are using so far, when you save the bug report, it comes up with number. So bug report IT is not what testers normally do. It was a provocative question. Steps to reproduce, obviously. When you write a bug report, a developer should know how to reproduce the bug, because otherwise developer doesn't know what you are talking about and cannot fix anything. So, and we have 100% response here, guys. It's amazing. Severity is how bad is the bug, and normally we have 4 levels of severity in most of the bug tracking systems. Could be 6, could be 10, could be God knows any number. But from the practical kind of standpoint, we have 4. The first one is critical, the second one is serious, then we have minor, and the number 4 is not really a bug, it's a suggestion, it's an enhancement. Testers come up with lots of enhancements, lots of ideas how to make things better. So in most of the systems we have 4 levels of severity, and severity is exactly what we have to do. So that 100% is, I like it a lot. Then priority. Guys, priority is not our business. So we have 30% of people saying tester will do priority. No way. When we talk about bug life cycle, it comes to tester finding a bug. Okay, we find a bug, what's next? Next, you write a bug report. Who is the first person to see your bug report? Some people say QA manager. Guys, if as a QA manager I have to look at all your reports, I would rather get another tester. I don't want to look at your reports. So you write a bug report, and the first person who looks at your report is the person who makes the decision of who is going to fix the bug. If you start identifying the person by title, and a lot of people do that, it's wrong. You cannot really be sure, because it might be development manager. Let's say if you look at my experience, it was always development manager. In some companies I know, it is a project manager, and we do not want any discussions on what is the title of that person. Guys, it doesn't matter. The only thing which matters is there is someone who assigns work to developers, and it is not you. And the person who assigns that work, he says, okay, you're going to fix it, and here is the priority. You will see one more field here. It says assigned to. Assigned to says you fix it. A tester normally cannot make a decision like that. I mean, under certain very rare circumstances, I can say, yeah, it is possible. But the probability of you being in that position is maybe less than 1%. So there is a person who does assigned to and who does priority. Normally, it is the same person. Then we are looking at reported by. Guys, reported by is generated normally by the system. When you say a new bug report, you push that menu item or whatever folder tab, and to say you are writing new bug report. In order to be able to do that, you have to log into the system. The system knows who you are. So bug tracking system does not need you to say it's me reporting the bug. They know. So 84% said reported by is what tester will fill out. I think probably you misinterpreted a little bit the question. You were thinking, is it important field, you know, but you didn't pay attention to who fills it in. It is a very important field, but it's not done by testers, guys. Assigned to, we just discussed, so it will be done by same person who does priority. And priority normally would be, let's say, high, medium, low, three levels of priority. Could be different from that. Short description, we have 100% of people saying short description. Guys, I'm really happy about that one, because or title, another name for short description is title. That is always in the bug report, and that is always what you do. And then we have expected result. Here, guys, we run into a very interesting discussion. If you look at the bug reporting form, for example, element tool bug reporting form, there is no field for expected result. There is no field for actual result. But when you write a bug report, what is the idea of bug report? You come to the problem, you point to the problem. Sometimes, not always, you have to say, okay, here is what happened, but what really should happen is that. So, directly or indirectly, you might be talking about expected result and actual result being different. It might not be directly talking, it might be not even indirectly talking, but it might be somewhere in the air. But the very idea of error suggests that there is something we want and something and it didn't happen. So even if you don't even think about that, you still point to the problem. And that problem is somewhere in the atmosphere. There are two different schools of thinking about it. Some people think, look, if there is a bug report and there is a problem, why don't we say directly, here is what should happen and here is what happened instead. In most of the bug reporting systems and most of the teams where you will work in QA, it is not going to be like that. So most of the people, most of the groups, they just point to a problem. They do not say, you know, that is what we expected and that is what happened, because number one, it takes more time. Number two, unless it is obvious, you know. So in most of the cases, it is obvious. So the expected result is obvious to people who are heavily involved in development and testing, so we don't have to mention. So when I look at your answers, that is my thinking. So there is something I'm happy about, and that is you understand the importance of expected result, and you understand the importance of actual result. But again, you might not pay attention to the bug reporting form and the fields in that form. So expected result and actual result mostly are in the kind of virtual world, not in the format of the bug report. There is another thing here, which is a common confusion. If we think about test case, so test case is our plan for testing. I mean, something very small, so the smallest actually. So, and we are saying, okay, here is the test case, and when we write the test case, we don't even have sometimes software in front of us. We are just projecting, we are saying, okay, here are the things I'm doing, and that is what I expect, and now here is the field for actual result, and the person who runs the test case will fill it out. For most of the people, 99.99% of people, when you say expected result and actual result, the first thing which comes to their mind is test case. Because those two are must in the test case. So expected is must at the time of planning, and actual is must at the time of execution. You have to fill it out. How do you write a bug report? The one is, says, immediately upon identifying the problem and making sure it is reproducible, and we have 78%, which is very good. Oh, absolutely, guys. We write the bug report immediately upon making sure we have a bug. We do not write it immediately upon scratching our head and saying, something is definitely wrong here, I'm not sure what. Okay, if you are not sure what, it's not time for writing bug report. So that one is pretty good. I just don't know why, some people decided not. I mean, it's not important to report the bug immediately. It is important. Rule of three W's, so which tells you if the bug report is good enough. It says, okay, the bug report is good enough if it explains what happened, where it happened, and under which circumstances. And my reason for giving you that rule was primarily coming from the situation when testers are trying to come up with better kind of literature of the bug report. They are trying to be more clear, and sometimes we spend lots of time working on the wording. And I'm saying, look, your time is too valuable. You have to look for more bugs. So if the bug report answers what happened, you know, where it happened, under which circumstances, don't make it a piece of nice literature, fine literature. Just keep moving. That is my reason for that rule. And we have 100% of people saying, yes, that is what we want in a bug report. Good. How we write bug reports. Write one bug report for no more than 5 fixes. Guys, we have multiple answers to provoke you for bad answers. And on one hand, and to point to the fact that one bug report is written for just one fix to be verified. If you put in one bug report more than one fix, then imagine you have 3 problems in one bug report and they fix one. What should you do now? To eliminate that, we are saying, okay, one bug report per one fix, per one problem. Okay, bug report should be as complete as possible. There's going to be another one on that. As complete as possible, we have 85%, and I don't know why we do not have 100. It should be as complete as possible. Because if it is not complete, you make developer to spend some time, which developer would rather spend fixing bugs rather than, you know, doing some investigation. Bug report is about creative writing, more like an essay. Guys, I'm happy with you. There was no single person who said it's about creative writing. Report a bug after discussing it with QA manager or QA lead. That is the easiest way to lose a job, because they have other things to be done, unless there is some clarity which needs to be brought to the issue. It's not about writing the bug report by itself, it's about the problem. What kind of problem? Is it a problem at all? So sometimes you discuss with your manager the circumstances, what happened, did it really happen, or so what is that? But when you write bug reports, you do not discuss them unless discussion is needed. Use technical terms, not people of the trade language. Again, I don't know why we do not have 100% here. It is a technical writing, and we do need technical language, technical terms to be used rather than people of the trade language. So I don't know why there was any confusion here. And then new testers. Guys, that last question comes from a discussion I had a couple of days ago. I was teaching a class. And it was the very last session of the class, so I was talking about job search. There was a job search class. And then one young lady, and she is doing her internship. And out of that class, maybe 5 or 6 people are already, you know, doing their internship. And she says, Michael, we have a discussion here, because another intern, another girl, she told me I am supposed to write lots of bug reports which are total crap. I'm saying, you're not supposed to write crap. She says, yes, the girl suggests that since you don't know the application anyway, so you cannot write anything but crap. And you have to be active. You have to write more bug reports than other people. Guys, it is a total, very dramatic misunderstanding, because that is the easiest way to lose a job. She does not understand. Anytime you write a bug report, you take somebody else's time. Guys, someone has to read that. And the first person who reads that is, let's say, development manager. Imagine how development manager will like you after that. And so you take people time for nothing, and you have total misunderstanding of what software testing is about and what her role is about. And I said, listen, since we talk about bug reporting, let's challenge you. And I included that question here. It says, new testers should submit lots of poor bug reports since they do not know much about the application testing. And we have kind of support here. 14% say, yeah. How can we write a good one? Guys, if you cannot write a good one, you write nothing. And that is a very simple answer. So you're not supposed to write crap. And be careful, because especially when you start working, guys, you do not want to expose yourself to such a miserable position in a company. Maybe it is confusing a little bit. Obviously, you do not know much about the product at the very beginning, which does not mean you have to write bug reports having no idea what you are writing. It means first couple of weeks nobody expects much from you. In terms of bug reports, they expect you to learn, you know, to progress in that. And that is one of the reasons we emphasized knowledge of graphic user interface. So when you start working and you don't know much about functionality, at least you can write bug reports on graphic user interface. So it is a total defeat of what we teach in the school. We are saying, first time, people do not expect much. And she says, yes, they expect a lot and they expect crap. Not even close. What is the single most important field of a bug report form? Guys, that is an interview question. It came to our list from actual interviews. A single most important field of a bug report form. The question by itself is very provocative because single field in the form is nothing. I mean, you cannot have a bug report in the form of just one field. But the idea of that question is, okay, if you have to keep just one, which one would you keep? So we have different opinions here. One says bug report ID. Okay, to analyze, let me ask you a question. So when you write a bug report, what is the ultimate goal in writing bug report? Why in the world you write that bug report? What do you want to achieve? Fix it, yes. From the perspective of fixing the bug, let's imagine you report a bug report. You are saying bug report number 75. Who is going to fix that? I mean, really, is it possible to fix the bug if all you know is just a number? No. So bug report ID obviously is not the most important one. Then we have priority. Guys, priority is important. And the severity is important. And altogether, we have 20% of you, over 20%, saying either severity or priority. But it is not the most important. You might say, you know what, something happened. It's real bad, but I'm not telling you. Yeah, go fix it. Then we have two candidates. We have steps to reproduce and short description. Short description is something nice. It gives people an overall idea of what happened, but it is not supposed to be good enough to reproduce the bug. So the only field which allows developer to fix it, it's not going to be convenient at all, but the only field which allows developers to fix it is steps to reproduce. Okay, keep moving. How can a tester be sure that bug was fixed? We have some provocative answers and some which are exactly what tester is going to be doing. So it says repeat the steps of reproduce in the bug report. Absolutely. Guys, sometimes we have to verify bug report fixed, which we didn't write ourselves. So let's say manager says, you know what, why don't you go and look at somebody else's bug reports, help him. And you start reading somebody else's bug reports. How do you know if it is fixed or not? It's not even you who wrote that. You just follow the steps. That is exactly how you make sure the bug is fixed. You follow the steps. Then we have a couple of more answers here. So one is get an approval of a QA manager, which is a severe violation of the processes, because QA manager has his own job and you are supposed to be writing good bug reports just to get a job. If you cannot do it, you cannot do the job, you cannot keep the job. Confirm with developer over the phone or via email. Guys, sometimes we do that. Sometimes, you know, certain things are not clear, so you call or email, but it is not exactly how testers normally do that. As an exception, yes, but not as a normal procedure. Then we have make sure there was nothing broken in related functional areas, which is normally part of what we are doing. Very good. And we have 43% saying, yeah, it's important. And that one, I don't know why, another 43% or same 43% said, make sure the status of the bug report is fixed. It is not how you, guys, the status could be anything. The status could be fixed, doesn't mean anything is fixed. So, It is not a part of the procedure. Unless the status is fixed, you will probably not know the bug is fixed. But it is not something you have to go and make sure. It's a part of your thinking, and it's a kind of something you take care about. Not really. It just happens. In the background, you never think about. Who can change severity in previously reported bugs? Who can change severity? Severity is something testers provide, not priority. Severity. So, who can change severity? Whoever has more rights than you do, guys. Not developer, though. A QA manager can change severity, absolutely. A tester can change severity, absolutely. There was a discussion, we reconsidered, and so I can change it. Developer cannot, guys. Developer cannot change anything. Then development manager, absolutely, development manager can change even priority. So he obviously can change severity. Marketing manager, business analyst, yeah, so good. Again, everything is possible under the moon. So let's say in that specific company, they allow business analysts to do that. But it is rather abnormal than kind of typical for software development organization. How many errors can testers submit on one problem report? Okay, now guys, we have choices. Only one error, no more than 5, no more than 10, unlimited, and normally it's like practically, yeah, it's 2-3 per bug report. So we have answers practically in all the categories with exception of unlimited. Okay. So someone says no more than 5, another one says no more than 10, some people say 2-3 is fine. So 20% are coming with wrong answers here. And as we discussed already, one bug report per one bug to be fixed and verified fixed. Good. And then we have, what is main purpose of finding bugs? Guys, when we find bugs and report bugs, obviously there are multiple things coming out of it. We have 93%, almost 93% who are saying to fix them. And honestly, I'm surprised why we do not have 100%. Because it is a major, from QA perspective, guys, that is the major aspect of finding and reporting a bug. So if it is not being fixed, so why then? I mean, maybe I would rather find and report another bug which will be fixed. So you want your bugs fixed. To inform management about existing errors. Obviously, guys, management keeps an eye on bugs reported, especially high profile bugs, critical bugs. So they want to know how bad the product is or how good the product is. And it is one of the important implications. Then it says to improve the development methodology so we have less bugs in the future. There are so many ideas in the atmosphere, okay, how to make it better. It comes to not being able to hire the right people, not having enough time, not having enough money, people working all over the globe, and now we have communication problems. And, obviously, it's not exactly why we write bug reports, but there might be some projection on that as well. To collect data for statistical analysis, yes and no. Obviously, there are some meetings, there are some discussions in which we look at statistics. But it is not why we really write bug reports. It's too expensive, you know, to get statistics that way. So again, it is one of the implications of the bug reporting system and bug reporting process. But it is obviously not the main purpose. And then we have very strong candidate, which comes with 35.7%, and that is to make sure the most severe problems are not present in release software. Guys, if the most severe problems are the main issue, why in the world we report problems which are not severe at all? Why would we report minor problems? Why would we report, you know, serious problems? Why don't we report just crashes? And by the way, In some companies, they will tell you, listen, unless it is a crash, don't even bother reporting. So it exists in the real world, but it is relatively rare. So some companies are kind of on the very edge of survival. They cannot really talk about high quality software. They just want to survive. They just need to come up with something, get another round of financing and survive for another 3 months or 6 months or 1 year. There is one discussion here which I want you to kind of be part of. In today's world, software cannot be quality software unless we are in a very narrow niche. Sometimes software is mission critical, so it might be of military, you know, usage, or it might be involving human life, or let's say medical devices or medical you know, applications, environmental, something real critical. So if something happens, God, it's going to be millions or maybe human lives and this and that. So otherwise, if you look at web applications, simple basic web applications, something which everybody is using every day, that software is supposed to be of a very low quality. Why it happens? Let's say you put $1 million and well, let me write it here. So let's say you make an investment of $1 million and let's say invest. And as a result of that, we have return. And our return is, let's say we are lucky, and it is positive. Guys, we are lucky because most of the people will probably lose money that way. And let's say we made $1.2 million. Huh? How do you like that? So we have 20% return on investment. And then, but software is crap. And you think, no, guys, next time we are not going to do that. Next time we are going to do real quality software. So we will invest $5 million. $5 million. How much money do you think we will get back on that? I mean, the dream quality software, real dream stuff. How much are we going to make? Tell me. It's not 1.2 anymore. How much? Six? Come on. not really. Okay, let's say 1.5 if you are lucky. Money-wise, it makes no sense. You can make it perfect, but that way you're going to lose money. So it should be good enough. And the market is so competitive. Think about web application. Think about mobile application. Think about, go to Google and search for something. See how much of competition is there. And competition comes with new features. I wouldn't say every day, maybe once a week, you know. And to survive, you have to do things fast. You do not have 6 months to produce quality software. You have to do that on the fly. We will talk in that course about agile development model. So it is supposed to be good enough. And good enough in today's world means crap, real bad one. Then, guys, what happens? Imagine we spend $5 million instead of $1 million. How soon do you think we have to completely redo the software? How long we will be benefited from that perfectly done software? For how long? 6 years? 10 years? 3 months? See what I mean? In the web applications world, it is not going to be for too long. So it literally makes no sense to produce, financial sense, to produce high quality software, especially in today's world.